The blood came streaming down. The blood came streaming down. The blood came streaming down for me. One day when I was lost, he died on the cross, and I know it was blood for me. He never said a mumbling word. He never said a mumbling word. He never said a mumbling word for me. One day when I was lost, Jesus died on the cross, and I know it was the blood for me. But guess what? He's coming again. He's coming back again. Will you be ready? He's coming back again. He's coming back again for me. One day when I was lost, he died on the cross, and I know it was the blood for me. They whipped him all night long.
Yes.
They whipped him all night long. They whipped him all night long for me. One day, oh, Jesus died on the cross, and I know it was the blood for me. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of Jesus.
Yes.
For he is certainly, certainly blessing us.
Yes.
To God be the glory forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Well, saints, if you have your Bibles, and I pray that you do, like to have your undivided attention. To God be the glory.
Hallelujah.
As we get ourselves situated and set for this word from on high, I want to take this opportunity to welcome everyone to another one of our Spirit Side Chats. Now, I want to continue chatting with you about being Christ's nature. That is his grace. God and natured continued. Who am I in Christ? One who looks forward to his inheritance. And as disciples and believers, we must know what this is.
Yes.
So Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you giving you glory and honor. We come before you praising your name and magnifying you, lifting you up and shouting hallelujah to the Most High precious God. Thanking you, Lord, for everything that you've already done, everything that you're currently doing, and everything that you're going to do.
Yes.
For we know in the end, we win. We are victorious. We are the victorious ones and not the victims. So we just bless you and we praise you, Father God, for another opportunity to come together in your presence, to give your name glory, to give your name honor, and to magnify and praise you. Let not one individual under the sound of my voice leave this place nor their devices without being provoked into opening up the word of God. We thank you, Father God, for giving us all an opportunity to become one with you, to be with you, to live you, and to see you.
Yes.
We just glorify you and we praise you. We pray all of this in the mighty name of your dear son, Jesus. And through our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, we say amen, amen, and amen.
Amen.
Now, as I have said before, know that God has charged me to get you prepared for home. You know what he told us, get ready and get them ready. Beautiful. Thank you, Brother Charles. Uh-oh, something happened there. If you could connect that back with that. Get ready and get them ready. So please turn with me to our anchor script of the day, which can be found in 1 Peter. 1 Peter 1. 1 Peter 1. And we're going to start at verse 3. But before we get started, kind of want to take care of some little housekeeping issues here. We're going to be staying with the divine revelation of the church because we are the church. Makes sense, right?
Yes.
But before we get started, please remember that Peter is speaking to us through authority. Remember that Peter is symbolic of the church and the representative of the body of Christ. You guys with me?
Yes.
With that comes the trust of God. Let me say that again. With that comes the trust of God. Don't you want God to trust you?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Amen. With that comes the trust of God to reveal himself to his church, to reveal himself unto us,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Because if you're in this life, or if you're in this living, then there should be a pressing need for God to reveal himself unto you. For God has a personal relationship with his body. A personal relationship with Christ brings about revelation from Christ, which gives us authority. Hmm? The authority to know God and to make him known.
Yes.
For we now have the keys to heaven. Thank you. For we now have the keys to heaven, right?
Yeah, right.
And that's knowledge, saints, which means we have the keys to life. He has given them back to us. I want you guys to stay with me here because this is important.
Yes.
And if you read the books of Peter, you will see that Peter is getting us ready to go home. Let me say that again. Peter is preparing us to go home. Why? Because Peter is symbolic of the church.
Amen.
And it's the church job to prepare us for a place that is called home. You guys feeling me?
Yes.
So he's getting us ready to go home and not preparing us to stay here. So there is a difference. Peter in these books, he's spitting fire. A consuming fire. Therefore, he's spewing God because God is a what? Consuming fire. And if Peter is spitting fire, which is a consuming fire, then he's teaching and preaching God. And as the church, this is what we are decreed to do, right? This is the only way that the gates of hell will not prevail against us if we speak truth, if we speak knowledge. But the knowledge is not knowledge of our own, but it is God's knowledge. 1 Peter 1:3-12 reads like this. Let me get my Bible opened here. And I'm reading out of the New King James Version. And it says here, and this is Peter speaking. He says here, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again. Whoa. You guys see that?
Yeah.
He has did what? He has begotten us again, to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. But I tell you, Peter is spit fire here. Peter's not playing church. He is the church. Look, look, look. To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. It's reserved in heaven for who? For me and for you.
Yeah.
Hmm? Jesus. He says here, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. You guys see that?
Yeah.
Look, I'm kept by the best, Brother Charles. Look, God is keeping me by his own power. We got to find out what that is. You guys with me?
Yeah.
In this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, If need be, you have been grieved by various what? Trials. Stay with me here. This is important. And Peter is giving us God's knowledge that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom, having not seen, you love. You guys with me?
Yeah.
Though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressibly and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This stuff is heavy. Of this salvation, the prophets have inquired and searched carefully who prophesied of the grace that would come to you. Are you guys feeling this? You guys catching this?
Yeah.
Of the grace that will come to you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ who was in them was indicating when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. To them, it was revealed that, not to themselves, but to us. Y'all seeing this? Look at what he's saying here. He's saying that we're special. Not to them, it was revealed that not to themselves, but to us, that they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things which the angels desire to look into. Yeah. To God be the glory. This is heavy, saints.
Yeah.
This is heavy. Mm. There is a lot to unpack here, and we're going to do that. Amen. Now, let me just say this to you. An inheritance is something that is passed at the owner's death. Can y'all say death?
Death.
See, without no death, there can be no inheritance. You guys with me on this?
Yeah.
See, someone's got to die in order for you to inherit what they own, because the possession is theirs. Not 9/10 of the law, it's theirs. You guys with me on this? So an inheritance is something that is passed at the owner's death to succeed in legacy to an heir or those entitled to receive it. In other words, like I said, without a death, there can be no inheritance. You with me on this, Sister Brown?
Yes.
Now, legacy is a gift properly given by will. Huh? See, in order for you to receive the gift, it has to be willed to you. You guys understand? That's what makes it legal and binding. You guys with me on this?
Yeah.
Now, not only can there be no inheritance, no, let me say this again. Not only can no inheritance be given without a death, but a gift from that inheritance cannot be given without a will. Y'all with me on this?
Yeah.
Stay, this stuff is good. The Father's will, and we know that he has a will, right? His will is that not one should what? Perish. But all should come to what? Repentance. That, saints, is abundant life. Y'all with me on this? Y'all agree or disagree? You agree? Say amen. That's right. So the inheritance is the legacy or the gift, which one is not entitled to until after a death, which has been specified in a will. See, what you gotta understand, that we're not just talking about what we think the death is. We're talking about experiencing a total separation from God. See, in order for us to get this legacy, to get this gift, one had to die to totally separate himself from God. Because that's the only death there is. In order for us to receive the inherited gift. You guys with me on this?
Okay.
Huh? And as I understand, only one has accomplished that feat. You guys with me on this? Without that death, there could be no inheritance. Because then the will would not have been what? Followed. The legacy or the gift for us is eternal life. Make no bones about it. It's not the stuff you receive here on this earth. I think I said to you guys the last time we were behind here, I used the example that someone gave me. I ain't never seen a U-Haul following a hearse. And you won't, right? Not unless the wife or the husband is moving. Moving at the same time. So the legacy or the gift or the inheritance then is eternal life. Mm-hmm. Nothing more, nothing less. And that is what we're striving for.
Yeah.
True? Yes, amen, that's right. Yeah. And Christ through Peter makes this plain to those who have ears to hear. See, the church has got to have ears to hear the divine revelation of God. Because without no ears, you will not hear and you will not receive nothing because you won't know nothing. Because if you don't know God, then you know what? Nothing. You guys with me?
Yeah, yeah.
But as I have always stated in the past, I want you guys to understand this. If you don't understand anything else, that God's word is full of what? Symbolism and representation. Let's chat about it. 1 Peter 3:1-5 says this, quote, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy," can y'all say mercy?
"Mercy
has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you who are kept," and that's if you're kept. See, in order for you to get it, Brother Charles, you got to be kept. I'm a kept man.
Yes,
y'all understand that I'm a kept man.
Amen.
He says here, reserved in heaven for you who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation. So you kept for a purpose.
Yeah.
You guys with that? For salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. My God, this is a powerful statement and a divine revelation of the church. And we should grab hold of the revelation. Why? Because we're the church. If you like it, love it, and share it. Look, look, look. First, understand that Peter mentioned the word mercy, right? Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy.
Yeah.
Mercy in short, saints, is this, a pardon of God. Can I say that again? Mercy, Pastor, in short, is a pardon by God. You guys with me? Therefore, the church uses Jesus Christ as our abundant mercy or as our abundant pardon, right? In other words, the church has been pardoned. We have been released from the penalty of an offense. That's what pardon is.
Yeah.
We have been released from the penalty of the offense. Huh? We have been forgiven. What kind of God is that? That will put on a cloak of flesh that will set, that would, first of all, that will put on a cloak of flesh, separating himself from his throne. And then coming down here, dwelling amongst us, and then take on the penalty of separating himself from himself for your purpose.
My God.
And then saying that your penalty has been paid in full. You guys with me on this? That your penalty has been paid in full, not because of what you have done, but because of what I have done for you.
Yeah.
What kind of God is that? Jesus. Now get this. get this, who has begotten us again? What? What? Have you guys ever asked yourself when you read that passage, what? What do you mean again? Well, if you've been coming to this ministry and you've been listening to these Spirit Side Chats, you know exactly what he's talking about. But just in case we can't quite recall, I'm going to walk you down that avenue once again. Look, 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 look. He says, who has begotten us again? What is that? To a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He has begotten us again. Well, the question would be, when was it that he first had us? That would be the question that comes to mind. When did you first have us? And the answer is, in eternity past. You know, quote, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Keep in mind that you're a spoken word. In him was life, and the life was the light of who? Men. That's eternity past, saints. John 1:1 and John 1:4. How about this one? Let us make man in our image according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over life. Genesis 1:26. That is when we first were given the keys to life. And then we lost them. You guys with me?
Yeah.
So then we lost them. And so that's where that again comes from.
Mm-hmm.
See, he's reconciling us back to him once again.
Yes.
We belong to him well before our fall. See, that's the begin. That's the again. See, you can't just look at this as eternity present. You got to take a look at eternity past, because if you don't know what happened behind you, you'll be doomed of what's happening in front of you.
Amen.
Isn't that what Brother Baldwin said? Huh? You got, yeah. We together, brother.
Yeah.
All right. Am I spitting fire? Come on now, Doc. And now, since the resurrection from death has occurred, and only one has completely separated himself from God to reconcile himself back to himself, or reconcile himself back to God. We couldn't do that. We can't do that. We have no power to do that. Even though we are a spoken word, we still can't do it. Only one could have done that. And since a resurrection from death has occurred, we have been profoundly pardoned and now belong to him once again, because the penalty for what we did was a total separation from God.
Yeah.
Nothing more, nothing less. In other words, through him, we have reclaimed life. We have that dominion again. And not only that, but life abundant. Yeah. Do you guys know what I'm saying? Life is different from life abundant.
Yeah.
Huh? We now have back the keys to life. And when I say the keys to life, I mean the keys to heaven. But we haven't discussed abundant heaven yet, or abundant life. You know, the new heavens and the new earth, which automatically, if you have the keys to heaven, which is life, then you're going to get abundant life.
Yeah.
Jesus, Jesus. We are now, once again, the light of the life contained within him. Can I say that again?
Yes.
Can I say that again?
Yes.
It's powerful. Look, 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 look. We now are once again the light of life contained within him. See, he did not come into us first. We were always present in him. You guys understand that?
Yeah.
See, that's the reason why he reversed this thing. Now he dwells on the inside of you. But check this out. Eventually, and when it's all said and done, we will once again dwell on the inside of him. You guys with me on that?
Yeah.
And because of his death, we are no longer dead, but now can experience the inheritance that God has for us, which is life. That's good news, y'all.
Yes, it is.
Huh? See, you can't have life if you're dead.
That's right.
You guys understand? And see, don't get into this natural stuff of what you think death is, of what you see in that coffin. That ain't death. It may be death to those who have not received Jesus as their Lord and Savior and have not lived his life on this earth.
Right.
But I'm not even the final judge of that. I can only say to you what the scriptures have said to me.
That's right.
You guys with me on that? And I do not deviate from the scriptures.
Right.
But guess who can? Guess who can? Because it's God who is. It's so much to God that we don't know. It's so much to the word of Christ that we simply don't know, that are not contained in just these 66 books of the Bible. You guys feeling me on that?
Yeah.
There's so much more diverse and vastness. You cannot contain him in 66 books. So he gave us what we needed.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Hmm? Yeah.
Yeah.
And in some cases, he didn't give us what we want. Because what we want ain't good for us. But what we need is always good for us. I like fried chicken and French fries, and if I could have that every day, I would. But I wouldn't be standing here now if I did. Because it's not what I what? Need. So the wife gives me some veggies. You understand what I'm saying? She give me some broccoli, but I eat it. Some asparagus, I like it. But my point is that if we were to get what we want, we would not have what we need. Therefore, we would have what? Nothing. Stay with me here. And because of his death, we are no longer dead, but we can experience the inheritance that God has for us. And I don't know about you, I don't want my inheritance. If somebody said that they decreed, or what is it? Bequeath something to me, I want it. You think you don't let an old aunt, a long time aunt you never knew, and somebody walk, knock on your door and said she left you in the whip. Oh, when is the meeting? You never met her, don't know her. Doesn't matter, right? You in your car and you going to that meeting. Because you won't what has been bequeathed to you. So understand that we belonged to him well before our fall. And see, that's where we get it twisted, Pastor Carolyn, because we don't look beyond the natural. You guys with me? We don't look at it that I was his and he knew me before I was formed in my mother's womb. And let me tell you guys something, and I may be getting off script here, but let me tell you something. You don't remember your existence before you got here. Quite naturally, when you go home, you may not remember your existence while you're here.
Oh, wow. That's deep.
Right. Because he wipes every eye dry.
Yeah.
You think he wants me concerned about a spirit that belongs to him, that once I call my son, if they don't make it, who hasn't made it? We belong to him well before our fall. And now, since a resurrection from death has occurred, we have been profoundly pardoned and now belong to him once again. That's what he means by that again. Y'all with me on this? In other words, through him, we have reclaimed life. And not only that, but life abundant. We now have back the keys to life. Let them have dominion over everything that creepeth on the earth, everything that flies in the sky, everything that swims in the ocean. That's life, y'all. And he gave all of that to us. Or symbolic of life. We are now once again the light of life contained within him, right? And because of his death, we are no longer dead, but can experience the inheritance that God has for us, and that much more abundant. Some keys or key points to life that is in heaven. This is what you have to look forward to. You guys, you ready?
Yeah.
Check this out. And Peter has told you. He says, life, number one, life is incorruptible and undefiled. So there's no corruption when we go home. There's no defilement when we go home. You guys with me on this? Number two, life does not fade away. It becomes stronger. That's the reason why it's called life, an abundant life. So it's not going to go away. It stays stronger. It gets stronger. So you don't have to worry about this reality ever diminishing. But see, this living does. And see, that's what everybody worries about. They worry about the diminishing of the living. You know, I don't want to die. I don't want to die. Now, I'm not saying that people should be walking around here saying, give me death. What is the saying? Give me death and give me liberty. I'm not saying that because God has a purpose for your life here. But what I am saying is that there should not be any fear about going home. And most people fear it. That's in the body of Christ. How many times I heard pastors say, well, it was time for them to go home. But when my time comes, not now, Lord. Oh, no, not now. No, I ain't ready to go now. Or something to that fact. Come on. Come on. Where's your faith? Look. Number three, life is a resurrection. From what? No, life is not a resurrection from death. Life is a resurrection from living. You guys understand that? See, there's a transition from where we are to where we're going. And no death is ever experienced in that transition. So we are resurrected from living to life. Those of us who are in Christ Jesus. Life, number four, life is eternal and has no separation from God. So all of your existence, you will be in the presence of the Holy One. Amen. You guys with me on this? There's no separation from him. Number five, life is love and gratitude. Huh? We talked about that in what? In our Bible studies. Life is love and it's gratitude. Number six, life is joy, it's peace, and it's happiness. Do you have that in this place? Really, truly, do you? Do you really, truly? Think about it. The only joy that you have is the joy of the Lord. And if you didn't have that, you would have none. You guys with me on this? There are many people sitting up with infirmities in their bodies without no hope. But because they don't know Jesus. But in life, you'll know him. You'll be one with him and he with you. Look. Life, number seven. Life is goodness, which is godliness. You guys with me on this? Number eight, and this is my last one. Life does not have a law. Oh, Jesus. Man. Let me say that again. There are no laws in life. Life does not have a law. The law is for the lawless. And in life, there is no lawlessness. None of us would be lawless. So there's no need for it. You guys with me on this? Yes, amen. That's right. Say it like you mean it. And all of this is reserved for us. That is, those of us who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed to us in the last time. Oh, let's unpack that. If we are kept by the power of God through faith, then the question is, what is the power of God and how does it keep us? Right? That would be the question. I'm reading this, I'm thinking, what is that, Daddy? Please understand this, that the power of God belongs to God. Let me say that again. The power of God, Sister Deidre, belongs to God. It's his. He possesses it. It's not yours. Huh? You guys with me on this? It's his power. And that's the reason why Peter said it. The power of God, the power of God belongs to God. while faith belongs to us. Ooh, Jesus, did I say something? Look. Therefore, the power of God is his grace. You guys see that? Well, let me break it down a little bit more for you. Grace is the freely given unmerited favor and love of God that we don't deserve. But because of his grace, he gives it. It is his influence, right? Which is his spirit operating on the inside of us to regenerate us, to strengthen us, and to transform us. You guys see that? That's grace. Without grace, you have nothing. You see that, Brother Tweedum? Amen. And faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things unseen. Note that the substance and the evidence are things we hope for, not God. Y'all see that? It is not what God hopes for. Look, even in his will, he didn't say, I hope that they should come to repentance. Huh? There's no hope. He gives the law. He wants you to come to repentance. But he's not hoping that you come to repentance. Why? Because the choice is whose? Yours. And that choice is made through what? Your faith. Jesus has always said, your faith has made you whole. He didn't say, my faith has made you whole. He said, your faith. You guys feeling me on this?
Yeah.
Look. Faith belongs to us. And not because of that. And because of that, we are called believers. See, you can't be a believer without faith. You guys understand what I'm saying? That's the reason why he calls us believers, because of your faith. Now, the power of God is grace, but you can't have God's grace without your faith. You guys with me on this?
Yeah.
For grace is God's favor, that is his helper, and faith is our hope, that is our belief. Right? Our faith is now in life, which is heaven. That's where we are. Note that the last time is contained in the last day. Let me say that again. The last time that Peter's referring to is contained in the last day. But it is a natural time when we will have the chance to taste life through the rapture. You guys feeling me? You see that? Huh? See, the rapture don't come in a spiritual nature to you. The rapture comes while you're natural and you're caught up. You guys understand? You can be driving your car and whoop. because there's going to be a lot of catastrophes.
Yeah.
You can be walking down the street and whoop. You guys understand what I'm saying? You will be caught up with him naturally, then become spiritual. Jesus. 1 Peter 3:1-9 reads like this. And this you greatly rejoice. What am I rejoicing about? Life. Though now for a little while, if need be, he said, if need be, Sister Deidre, huh? That's the reason why we got to get a hold of scripture. Look at what he says. You have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, you can't have phony faith. See, either your faith is for real or it's not. And only God is the judge of that. Being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen you, who, having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him, yet believing. Yet what?
Believing.
Yet what?
Believing.
That is your what? Faith. You rejoice with the joy of, with the joy inexpressible, and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, salvation for your souls. Oh, stay with me here. This is power packed. We should be greatly rejoicing for the return of Jesus. That's what this, that's what Christ is saying. That's what Christ is saying through Peter. That's what Christ says that his church ought to be doing. You know, why am I interested in discussing what your man did to you and that there's a better day coming? Because you may run out, quit that man, and get another one just like him. Normally, that's what we do. Same with men. That woman did you wrong. Well, I'll leave her, but I'm going to go get another one who is the same way. Not interested. Holy Spirit, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We should be greatly rejoicing for the return of Christ, for him to reveal his salvation. That is his life to us. This should be the first and foremost teaching of the church. You guys getting me? Say, well, Pastor, that ain't true. Yo, yes, it is. Why are we doing this? What are we doing this for, a new Mercedes? I like to have one, but I mean, you guys with me on this? Like to have a new house, but you know, that ain't the end all, that be all. Christ is. Look, this should be first and foremost the teaching of the church and the expectation of the body. We have an expectation, y'all. Look. Why would the body that belongs to a head not have a desire and yearn for its head? Why? How could that be? I don't know. I may be outdating some people. Do you guys remember the headless man that used to come on TV? And he used to always do this because he had no head, but he was running and walking all into stuff. You remember that? I said I may be outdating myself. So, well, yeah, it was a movie.
Yeah.
It was a movie. Look. As the body of Christ, we have an expectation for the head. Right? We should have an expectation and a desire for our head to be placed in its rightful position, and or the body to be placed in its rightful position. Come, Lord, come. Even though we're trapped in the furnace for a little while. You guys catch that? Even though we're trapped in the furnace for a little while, you better go over to Daniel and find out what the furnace is. Look. The furnace is living. Let me say that again. The furnace itself is living. Y'all with me on this?
Okay.
And the King of Living is demanding us to bow down to his image and reject the Lord of our salvation. You see that? See, that's what living does. That's what those phones do. That's what everything does. It is influenced and it is persuasive and it's persuading our young people to bow down to the enemy and forsake our Lord and Savior Jesus. You guys with me on this? I'm going to be done in just a few minutes. In fact, the more we resist the King of the Living, and that's the King of this world, he turns up the furnace. Isn't that right, Sister Deidre?
Yes.
He turns up the furnace. Ask my mother-in-law. Yes, he does. Pastor Allen, he turns up the furnace when you resist him. You guys with me on this?
Yes.
Things go happening in what? Your world, which is this flesh. It don't react and act in the same way. And for those of us who are young, keep living. Just keep living. And you'll see exactly, and you'll probably remember back, Charles, and say, I remember that man speaking about this. Look. The more we resist the king, and I know you resist the devil and he shall flee, and that's true. But there's a reason why he flees. And that's what Peter is telling us here. The more we resist the king of this world, the king of the living, he turns up the furnace. The heat represents trials, turmoils, and tribulations that the king, that is the enemy, sends our way. Huh? Read Daniel. Even the enemy people couldn't keep up with it. They perished even before placing them in the furnace. And here you are, surviving the very heat. That's those of us who survives it. Because there's some of us who get close to the furnace and feel the heat and take ourselves out. You guys understand me?
Yes.
Look. The heat represents our trials, our turmoils, and tribulations that the king, that is the enemy, sends our way. But know that through the heat is a fire. Let me say it again. Through the heat is a fire. You guys with me on this? A consuming fire. That is in the image of the one we serve. So even though you're in the furnace and in the fire, does not mean that the King of Glory is not right there with you, protecting you.
Amen.
You guys with me on this?
Yeah.
See, the one we serve, since we don't bow down to the image of the living, he helps us to overcome the heat of the king, that is the heat of the enemy. You guys with me on this?
Yes.
The Son of God represents overcoming the system, which is prone to death. The furnace, which is prone to ungodly heat. And the living. And our hope, which is the realization of life. And it is all based upon our what? Faith, our hope. Understand that without trials, turmoils, and tribulations, there can be no inheritance. Oh, I think I said a mouthful. Huh? Let me ask you this question. The angels in heaven, are they going to receive this inheritance?
No.
Okay. Point proven. Y'all with me on this? Our faith must be genuine. Meaning that our faith or our hope must be free from pretense, hypocrisy, and not be counterfeit.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
It must be sincere. Sincere faith is more precious than gold to God.
Amen.
That's what you have. You have that possession that you own, that God desires and wants and needs. Our faith has to be genuine. And it's more precious than gold to God. For when it is tested by fire, it will not perish. Stay with me, sis. Stay in the heat. Stay in the fire. God is going to see you through it. I see you, and I'm praying for you every bit of the way as I'm speaking.
Thank you.
Just scream out to Christ if you have to. Lord Jesus, we understand, because that's part of being in the furnace.
Yes.
You with me on that?
Yes.
So what does sincere faith in this case look like? It looks like a desire and a longingness to be with Jesus. Plain and simple. Through all of your trials, tribulations, and turmoil will not keep you or separate you from Christ. It's living his life and praying for his return before even praying for his own health. And Christ has experienced the tribulations, the turmoils, and the trials. You think it was easy being nailed to a cross?
No.
You think he didn't feel the pain? Huh? Oh, hit me with another nail. Oh, no, you know what? This is not good enough. You know, go through the middle of my eyes.
Come on now.
You guys understand that? Jesus, our Lord. It's living and praying for his return, even before praying for our own health. That's a mouthful. Huh? Jesus, this is believing in him and not believing in ourselves. Right? And if this be our case, then we will see an end of our faith. We will see an end of our hope. We will see an end of our desire. But you got to understand, with the salvation, we will see an end of all of this with the salvation of our souls. Our soul is the breath of God, which is the substance of God, which is the life of God, which will return to God, and thus he will obtain us once again. You guys with me on this?
Yeah.
What you got to understand is that your faith will come to an end. Therefore, look, the soul is life. That light that is contained in him. Why? Because in Genesis 3 and 7, I believe it is, he did what? He blew himself on the inside of you, and you became a living what? Soul. King James Version.
Yeah.
Huh? Huh? So that means there's life in the breath. Jesus. The light that is contained in him that fell into living until the resurrection of the breath. See, he revises his breath. See, what you have to understand is that he performs CPR on us. Amen. You guys understand that? Huh? Boof, boof, boof.
Yes.
And we were revised once again. You guys with me on this?
Yes.
This then will be the end of our faith. For faith does have an ending. You don't keep faith forever. It's not eternal. Faith has a beginning and it has an end. Grace, however, is eternal. You guys see that? God never takes his love from you, even when you're home. Jesus. The last of this. 1 Peter 3:10-12. And I know that I've kept you guys long. Of this salvation, the prophets have inquired and searched carefully. The prophets did what? They inquired and searched
carefully.
Who prophesied? They prophesied, right? The prophets do what? They prophesied, right? And this is what they prophesied. Of the grace that would come to who? To you. It did not say that would come to them. It said come to us. And there's a reason why Peter put it that way. And there's a reason why the prophets had it that way. Oh, Jesus, this stuff is good. Searching what manner of time. Yeah, say time. The Spirit of Christ who was in them was indicating when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. See, there's a glory that follows suffering. You guys understand me? There's a glory that follows living. It's called life for us. To them, it was revealed that not to themselves, but to us. See, it wasn't revealed to them, the prophets. You guys with me on this? Stay here. I'm going to let you go after this. God. Not to themselves, but to us. They were ministering the things which now has been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit, sent from where? From home, from life. See, God's Spirit is life. Oh God, there's so much here. I gotta move on. There's so much here. Things which angels desire to look into. You guys feeling that? Wow. Whoa. Please note this. Please note that even the prophets who have preached salvation to the house of faith did not fully understand it themselves.
That's right.
Oh, Jesus. Yes, amen. That's right. Thank you, Pastor Carol. Jesus, that is profound. You guys feeling that? That is profound. Look. If the Holy Spirit comes to us, why wouldn't life, that is Christ, come back for us? Rhetorical question, but ponder it. See, God sent his Spirit to us. And if he sent his Spirit to us, we didn't go to his Spirit. The Spirit came to us. Why wouldn't Christ come back and get us? Why wouldn't he send Christ back to get us? Think about that. Look. This is what the prophets inquired and searched carefully for. Because there's got to be something to this that God is downloading in us. But there's a reason why they couldn't figure it out. Understand that even though they were operating out of the Spirit of God, they had no understanding of the Spirit of God. Y'all see that? The Spirit of God was not made known to man until after the utterance of Jesus Christ. Oh, Jesus, in John 14:15-18, I will send to you another helper. You guys getting this? Yeah. The house of faith didn't have that. Jesus sent that to the house of grace. Oh, Jesus. Understand that the same Spirit that dwelled in us dwelled in them. It did. He did. But they were not knowledgeable about him. He lay dormant. He didn't transform. Why? Because it was by faith. But they knew that in time, can y'all say time?
Time.
He would come and that he would manifest his glory through us. It's got to be something else to this, gang. Therefore, their ministry, and we're talking about the prophets, right? Let's not get it twisted. Their ministry was not in vain. Because they were ministering to us, that is the household of grace. See, sometimes you may say things now that someone may not get what you're saying for generations later.
That's right. Yeah.
You guys with me on this?
Yeah.
That's the reason why, Brother Charles, I don't fear not having a super ministry. Because God's word is what God's word is. And if he wants it to get out, he'll make manifest it to whomever will listen. Jesus. Now understand this. Understand that the Holy Spirit sent to us baffle the angels in heaven. Can y'all see that? Look. The Holy Spirit. Jesus sent his Spirit to us to dwell on the inside of us, which they ain't got. Read your word. Understand that the Holy Spirit sent to us baffle, perplex them, the angels in heaven, and they have a desire to look into what manner of trust that God has in us, that he would give us the keys to life. Which, saints, which includes the angels in heaven. You guys seeing that?
Yeah.
Well, no, Pastor. How is that? Well, read 1 Corinthians 6:3. Read Romans 8:17. Which is our rightful inheritance? Read them. Which is our rightful inheritance? And we are what? Joint what?
Heirs.
With who?
Christ.
With Christ. He did not say that we were joint heirs with who? The angels?
No.
Jesus. Jesus, enough said, who am I in Christ? One who looks forward to his inheritance. God be the glory forever and ever and ever.
Amen.
Love it, like it, and share it.
And if you don't know, now you know, saint. For those of you who want to look forward to your inheritance, then please become part of the good news. And that is
Christ is born, Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will return again. Y'all see how it always gets back to Jesus?
Yeah,
absolutely. All roads and all paths of eternity leads right to him.
Yes.
Then what I want you guys to do is to make this declaration after me. I want you to say, God, I know that I am a sinner. And I ask for your forgiveness. I believe that Jesus Christ is your son.
I believe that Jesus Christ is your son.
Oh, say it with emphasis. Say it like me. I believe that Jesus Christ is your son.
I believe that Jesus Christ is your son.
Come on, somebody. I believe,
that
he died for my sins.
And he died for my sins.
And that you raised him to life.
And that you raised him to life.
I trust him.
I trust him.
I trust him. As my Savior. And will follow him.
And will follow him.
As Lord. From this day forward. Guide my life. And help me to do your will.
I pray this.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Now, if you have just repeated that prayer after me for the very first time, then I say, welcome to the household of grace through your faith. The angels of heaven are rejoicing. Jesus has his arms stretched out wide for you. And I am just simply overjoyed because we have another family member in the household of grace. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I think I have did my time and probably even more so. So I am going to take my seat and say this to you. I pray that this was understandable. You really need to read Peter. Because Peter is all about that life. Peter is all about preparing us to go home, which is what the church is supposed to do, which is the divine revelation of the church. Why would we want to stay here? I don't know about you, but you know, well, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you, giving you glory and honor. We come before you, magnifying your name and thanking you, Lord, for what you have done in this hour. We glorify you. Father, we know that your word is true. It is truth personified. And Father, no matter what anyone says, or try to debate, there's only one God, and that's you. So therefore, Father God, I put my hope and faith, my trust in you, because I know that you're leading, guiding, and directing us into all understanding of who you are, so that we can know you and make you known. And in that peace, Father, you're transforming us back into your image and likeness. For when we stand at the seat of Christ to receive judgment and to be held accountable, there will be no accountability because you will see yourself illuminating through us. And therefore, will judge us in our rewards. So we know that Jesus is soon to come back. But Father, we say, let him come now. Come, Lord, come. We extend an open invitation for you to come this second, this minute of this hour. Let the world see your rapture and taking your people up out of this living. And resurrecting us into life. We just glorify you and we praise you. We pray all this in the mighty name of your dear son, Jesus, and through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And let the church say amen again.
Amen.
To God be the glory. Well, let me take my seat. I think I just, once again, as Pastor Watson used to say, I have just taught myself happy. If you didn't get it, shame on you. I got it. It was good.
Thank you. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.